Ladies and gentlemen, Frank Warren for Queensbury Promotions, sponsored by Raynham Steel and Coral, proudly presents 10 three-minute rounds for the WBO Intercontinental Middleweight Championship. Your officials are appointed by the World Boxing Organization, and your three scoring judges at ringside are Mr. Ferenc Buday of Hungary, Mr. Steve Gray of the UK, and Mr. Mihai Alu of Romania. Your WBO supervisor is Mr. Dennis Gilmartin of the UK. Your timekeeper at the bell is Dave Waters. And when the action begins, your referee in charge is Mr. Phil Edwards of the UK. And now to introduce the contestants. Firstly, fighting out of the red corner stands the challenger, a man with a record of 15 wins, 6 losses, with 4 KOs to his name. At yesterday's weigh-in, he scaled 11 stone, 5 pounds, 12 ounces, and tonight, he wears the red shorts. Please welcome from Helsinki, Finland, Timo Laine. And across the ring in the blue corner stands a man whose unbeaten record reads 16 wins with 5 KOs to his name. At yesterday's weigh-in, he scaled 11 stone, 5 pounds, 12 ounces. And tonight, he wears the white and navy shorts. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Commonwealth and WBO Intercontinental Middleweight Champion from Biddeford by way of Birmingham, Tommy Langford. Your referee will now give his final instructions to both boxers.
Gentlemen, you've had your instructions in the dressing room, you know what I expect of you. Follow my commands when I tell you to break, break cleanly and take a step back. Watch your heads in close. And remember, defend yourselves at all times. Touch gloves, good luck.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the WBO Intercontinental Middleweight Championship.
According to the records, Tommy Langford only half an inch taller than Timo Laine, but he looks a little bit more than that to me. Tommy Langford still undefeated, 16 pro fights now under his belt, and he's acquired the Commonwealth title, beat Derbyshire's Lewis Taylor. Tough guy is Taylor, and Tommy did a pretty good job, 118 and 111 on two cards, 118, 110 on the third. And it was his birthday 4 days ago, so looking for a bit of a celebration here.
He's already come out nice and sharp. Now the nice little uppercut there and in close.
Fourth defence of this WBO Intercontinental Middleweight title. The Finn comes into this on the back of 5 victories all this year. He's been a pro since 2010. And like one or two other famous fighters, notably Bernard Hopkins, lost his pro debut.
It doesn't always mean anything, does it? Sometimes
doesn't make him a bad man, does it?
Well, better lose the first than lose him when it counts.
That'll get Twitter going, won't it? With people giving various examples of other people who've lost on their pro debuts.
Off the top of my head, Sanchez
loses
first?
Did he?
Not sure.
There was the guy who fought Floyd Patterson, wasn't there? He went straight from being the Olympic champion straight
Peter
into
Rainmaker.
A world title fight, yeah. Pete Rademaker.
Good body shot there from Langford, that's good.
Trying to be busy, isn't he?
Well, Langford's another fighter, almost in the same mould as Skeet in many ways. A guy who we thought is a really good technical boxer, a good thinker, but seemed to lack a little bit of physical strength.
Nice right hand, Barry, sorry.
But what difference he's shown in his last few fights? He's showing us, he's, all of a sudden, he's matured a little bit more, physically stronger, and likes to, be a bit more, aggressive, be more assertive in his work.
Looking for plenty of variety of shots here, and he's only in the opening round here, but he's starting to give Liner a bit of a working over in the closing minutes of this round.
What's good for Langford here as well, he's not getting too close with his shots.
Birmingham University graduate, of course, is Tommy. Mum and dad both teachers.
They must have been over the moon when he decided to become a boxer. Good start there for Langford.
Tom Cheney's trainer.
Stalked a little bit more then and sat in front of him earlier on. Keep moving there. Put the right hand here. Keep cracking him down there. Keep cracking, break him up. Yeah. When you actually get close and in the pocket, you've got to let go. Wait a little bit there. Keep touching him. Yeah. Don't go head on to him for now. Don't go head on to him for now. Yeah. He's grabbing up. Keep cracking him around here. Patient. Tapping in here, tap. Walking back in the punch. Need that feint. It's coming low, yeah? On the outside of it. Yeah? Good luck. Right. When you're in the pocket, let him go. Yeah? Body. Jab in there, man, yeah? Come on.
Well, that was an impressive opening round from Tommy Langford. It's 10 round of this. And unquestionably, he now has one in the bag. And signs in that last minute or so that he may well be looking for another inside the distance win here. Looks as though he's got very much more in the locker than Liner.
Well, Liner certainly looked like a neat little boxer, but I think once Langford put it on him a little bit, he's gone a little bit gun shy.
Big Marvin Hagler fan is Tommy Langford. Not much like him in the way he fights,
no,
but he loved it.
That's where it ends, really, yeah.
He's about 5 inches taller for a start, and he's not a southpaw. He also likes to think or models himself on Joe Calzaghe, and that's not a bad person to try and mimic.
He's a nice neat boxer, is Langford. And I said, he's adding that physical strength now, and he's more assertive, he looks for the finish.
There's not a lot coming back from his challenger here.
Now, what's good here for Langford is he's taking little steps to the side, just little movements. So Joe used to do it in a different style, where he would always be moving like as if you're going around the clock face. Just so when the opponent goes to throw back, you're just on the little bit of the outside of the punches. Means they've got to turn. They've got to turn to hit you, and those added, half a second or millisecond sometimes is enough for you to see the punches coming back your way. Just stand, sometimes people stand in front of your opponent, throw their punches, do good work, stand in front of your opponent, and they're tired, they get hit back themselves.
Langford having things absolutely his own way. The pattern of the opening round being repeated here in the second. Again, good footwork again.
Yeah, good movement around the body there, looking for the angles. And also, he's staying at that distance that suits him. So Liney there, he can't reach him because he's too far out, because he's got such long arms as Langford. He's a much taller fighter. And he's not getting too close, allowing his opponent to work with him.
And Liner's showing absolutely nothing, is he? Opening round, he had his moments in the first minute or so, but since then, it's been all Langford.
He's trying to get you can see him just a little bounce there in his step, trying to get a little bit of rhythm to his work. But his distance is all wrong because Langford's got his distance first using that jab. He's online and looks to do something, Langford just pops that jab in his face. And he has to reset, and then Langford comes forward.
Tommy Langford's been a pro since 2012. A couple of good wins back in the amateur days. Anthony Fowler. Callum Smith as well. And that's two out of two.
Yeah, he's at that level now where he steps on. He's the Commonwealth champion.
Combination together now. You kind of get your feet there. Yeah. Yeah? Don't start from too far out. One more gear. Okay, one more gear now. Not erratic, educated. Educated.
Yeah, don't be close.
In the pocket, don't be close enough, throw enough. Stiff. Really get back on the feet.
Kerry Kay's acting as assistant in that corner. Not too many people in the UK know more about conditioning than him. He's the one who kept Ricky Hatton in the ring for all those years when Ricky was sometimes having his own approach as to how to make the weight.
He must have hated it. When Ricky came back to start the training camp and seen the size of him, thought, oh, here we go all over again.
He earned his money, didn't he? Only joking, Ricky. Good stuff from Langford. Used to be a bodybuilder once upon a time, you know?
Yeah, I think that's
and
right.
A very highly rated one.
Well, I think they're experts in how to control their weight, aren't they? Because they've got to know how to cut weight properly. The right food to eat. It's a good display from Langford. It's not just neat boxing. He's being aggressive with it. He's looking for the finish.
And he's making it a one-horse race so far.
Well, he's looking for the finish without taking any silly risks as well. And it's all about where you plant your feet, you know, your judgment of the distance.
Lovely variety of shot. Body shot, that is. Yeah. Didn't like it, did he? Complained to the referee, thought it was low. Another one on the same spot.
Well, the good thing with that for Langford there, he landed with some good shots, just a half a step out there. And Laney tried to throw a punch and he's hitting fresh air.
Well, the body shots are really taking it out of Liner and the gloves starting to come down a little, presenting some openings up top as well for Langford. Absolute one-sided battering this.
Yeah, he's giving him a good going over, isn't he? Good pressure fight there from Langford. You can see Liner, if you give him a little bit of space, a little bit of time to come forward and work, I'm not saying he's a great fighter or anything, he's got a bit of skill, good bit of movement on him, but Langford's movement's been superb.
He's been outgunned, hasn't he, and he's being hurt by these body shots.
And I don't think Langford's ever going to be a KO artist. I'm not saying he can't knock people out, but he's never going to be a KO artist, but you can almost definitely see that he's going to be wearing people down, breaking people's hearts. A little bit, again, a lot like Bradley Skeet. He said, he comes forward more, does Langford.
Well, he's absolutely taking him apart here. And nothing really is coming back from Liner. I think there's starting to be an argument that the referee is going to be taking a look at this and wondering whether or not it's going to be allowed to continue. He was very, very much in close attendance there, Phil Edwards, watching to see if anything was coming back from Liner. And I don't think a great deal was. And I wonder whether or not he himself actually wants too much more.
I don't think Liner's hurt. I think that's why the referee didn't step in. But you've got to throw punches back, and the referee has no option if you're not defending yourself. And I think Liner's been overwhelmed. And he just can't read the fight at all at the minute.
Talk about the British title, of course, for Tommy Langford, and that raises the rather interesting possibility of Chris Eubank Jr.
Well, you think Eubank would still want to defend his title, because now, obviously, the Golovkin fight is thrown on the bed for him. He has, his options are reduced, aren't they? So I think Langford against Eubank, I know Langford fancied the fight, but I think Eubank would almost definitely fancy the fight.
be a good one, wouldn't it?
It would be a good one. Could it be all action? I think to Eubank Jr.'s credit, he's been a busier fighter since we've seen him, since the Saunders defeat. I think he's another guy who's learned from his defeat. Oh, good right hand there.
Well, just when we were completely writing Liner off, he comes out and starts fast, and he just stunned him a little bit with that right hand, I think. See what sort of response Langford can bring now. And it's good.
Oh, it's good right hand back there from Langford.
I thought he looked as though he's just... That's a good right hand from Langford. I thought that Liner looked as though he's just about spent at the end of the third round. Looked as though he pretty much didn't want to know, did he? But he's... Landed a couple in the early stages, but now Langford's powering it on again, and the referee's watching closely to see if Liner fires back.
Well, Liner just threw enough punches there, though, didn't he, to stop the referee from...
Yeah, it's kind of just, isn't it?
That's where he gets him there, Langford, those body shots. And I would rally upstairs, three or four punches upstairs, and then whip one down really fast across the body.
Like that.
He moves across that around the body, tremendous.
I don't think he's got too much willpower left now, Liner. He keeps looking across at his corner as much as to say, what have you got me into here?
I don't think he's seriously hurt, though. I just think he's being overwhelmed. Been a good work rate though from Langford. Very busy he's been.
Liner trying to get up onto his toes again, trying to get a bit of movement into those legs.
Well, Langford's having success there with that looping right hand when he gets lying on the ropes. For me, I just get him to half a step back and I throw an overhand right, I dip the shoulder, dip the head, and throw an overhand right. Just take a little step to the left and then let that right hand go with everything you've got.
Again, Liner just about doing enough as he works off those ropes to convince the referee that he's still got something left and still got some ambition, but that's another big round for Langford, and I think the referee just having a word with him and asking him if he's okay.
Well, I think, you know, he fought back just enough to keep him in the fight.
Just.
That's all it is, and I guess, yeah, there's no ambition. All his plan is for Langford to tire himself out.
The body. Okay. That's smart with his coming out on the outside. A few more jabs getting you there now.
Nose
a punch. Okay.
Yeah. While you're watching Tom Cheney there with Tommy Langford, the referee just went across to the Liner corner, and I'm not sure he didn't say, I want to see a few more punches being landed, and maybe also talking about that nick around the eye and the nose has gone as well, and maybe just telling them that it's his punches that have done it.
Yeah, I think it was the little cut above the left eye of Liner. That, I just think the referee was saying this, it was a punch, nothing else.
Well, a heck of a lot have landed. Not got a punch stat to give you, but it would be overwhelmingly in Langford's favour. Can't think that Liner's landed more than a dozen or so meaningful punches in four rounds of the fight.
And Langford can't miss with that right hand, especially the looping one, just round the guard of his opponent, finding it easy to hit the target.
He's a classic example of what people mean when you say step to the side to create a bit of space, isn't he? He does it so effectively, Langford.
Just maybe he's doing nothing wrong. Just maybe just change the tempo of some of the punches. So sort of shoe shine upstairs, so it's faster and lighter, and then dip down with a heavy shot to the body. Well, just that change in tempo at times just confuses your opponent.
That was the Calzaghe speciality, wasn't it? Half a dozen which were just sort of range finders, and then the combinations ended with the big hook or something.
That's right, yeah. I don't want to take credit for that.
You taught him all he knows, did you?
Not at all. I just don't want to take credit for it.
Well, don't.
Oh, good right hand there from Langford.
I presume that all birthday celebrations were put on hold for Tommy Langford when he celebrated his 27th 4 days ago. Maybe he'll be able to unwind a little bit after this. Liner's the one who's holding.
Well, it's a strange performance from Liner, because he came out in the first round looking like he might, you know, give it a go, but then...
It's just totally lacking ambition, isn't it?
Yeah, he's been on box and he's been struggling to find the range, and that's all to do with Langford. You know, he found the range first and established his jab pretty early. But I don't think Langford has really hurt him, so I think maybe he would be a little more adventurous, take a risk.
You don't think those body shots have had a bit?
No, I think that all the punches are taking effect. I don't think he's been buzzed, massively buzzed, but I don't think he's taken a shot off Langford. No, I'm gone. Oof, I can't take too many more of those. The Langford's hit them clean, but not heavy.
Completely one-sided so far. And as you say, as another right hand thuds home, he just can't miss with that shot, can he?
But then he's just showing there, like, he took two, landed two of his own straight ways. He's showing that he can do a bit when he wants to, but he has no ambition. Langford's dominating absolutely everything. Good there, whipping across the body there with those hooks. Langford just trying to take the breath away of Liney.
I'm feeling right, yeah, looking good, getting the nice shots up. Yeah. Gotta find the gaps, really, just find the gaps. Yeah. Haven't got to be power every time. Yeah. Touch him and bully him around and all that. Gotta bring him into the full potential. I need you to start attacking with that right hand now, okay. As you said, yeah. Touch and draw the shot and attack the right hand.
So into the sixth round. And into the second half of the fight. Langford. We've got him 5 rounds out of 5. Emphatically leading this fight so far. Liner a little bit more mobile now. Still not really throwing anything.
But he's got to try. You've got to slip inside the shots of Langford. You know, moving back just gives Langford one opportunity to move forward. And also, he's on the end of the shots, which is the last place you want to be when you're fighting a taller fighter.
He'll be looking for a more hurtful right hand, trying to respond to the instructions of Tom Cheney. Touch him and then really go for it. It is. Not able to prize a way through for the headshots, though.
Maybe a bigger step to the right when he gets him on the ropes for Langford. Almost be on the side of him and then just really dig that left hook in the body. Or the uppercut.
Looks as though Langford was going to get him out, didn't he? Particularly when Liner was just on the ropes throwing just nothing back. I thought the referee was going to stop it at that stage, but Langford's not really moving him now.
No, Liney doesn't look troubled at all, does he? And even though he's not doing anything, he's not troubled by anything either.
good shot, good right hand. Walked into it, didn't he?
He did, lovely shot. This is where he got to put his foot on the pedal now, Langford.
And he's doing so. He's trying to stamp himself on Liner right there and right now, trying to keep the pressure on.
This is where the fast combo, the fast straight punches here for Langford.
It's been a fairly woeful performance from Liner, though, hasn't it? You kind of try to be kind to people, but he's done precious little when it's clearly an opportunity.
Yeah, well, it's a big opportunity for him, and he's shown flashes that he could be competitive. I don't think he's good enough to beat Langford at all, and he might have got caught cleaner and hurt if he would have shown a little bit of adventure. But just showing bits sometimes that he can be useful.
No, knock down, you're not allowed to sling somebody to the ground like that, but a bit of frustration from Langford as much as anything else.
Well, again, he looked like he was going to get him out there. He caught with a lovely time right hand as Laney came forward, and then he did put his foot on the pedal, he did accelerate with his punches. It just wasn't enough.
Yeah. Keep plugging away, doing well, got to stay switched on, yeah? You know when he's holding you, try and get the distance again, then come back again, yeah? Let's attack that jab of his now, straight right hand, bam. Yeah. Little side step, look over his shoulder.
Of interest down here for this bill, of course, particularly that fight later on. Effectively top of the bill, the British and Commonwealth Super welterweight title, which is our last fight after the two world title fights, Liam Williams and Gary Corker, and it's really caught the imagination of the Welsh journalists down here. That's coming up, and before then you've got Guillermo Rigondeau and Jazza Dickens and Terry Flanagan, and then Zong Kifana, two world titles before what should be a terrific domestic scrap. And this is now getting very, very one-sided indeed. I think this can be stopped, and indeed it has been. And that is not a moment too soon. It was absolutely one-sided. An avalanche of punches coming in from Langford. Liner, I don't think, didn't like the fact that he was stopped, because he was still there on his feet, but it was absolutely a one-sided boxing display from Langford, and you have to say that he did his job and did it well.
Yeah, he did. Again, you know, he's not the biggest of punchers, and that's evidence, but he's been more aggressive than he used to be in the past. You know, his working around the body when he gets a guy on the ropes is quite impressive. He's always looking for the different angles. His work is tremendous, and I think the fact that Laney wasn't aggressive, didn't want to fight back, makes it harder to penetrate through the defence at times. But he stuck to his task, he done his job, and in the end he got the deserved stoppage.
And when the end came, although there wasn't one huge shot which caught the eye, there'd probably been seven or eight pretty much unanswered headshots which had gone in, so I think Phil Edwards did what was right. Victory again, and Tommy Langford is centre ring. He will have the belt, keep that WBO Intercontinental Middleweight title belt. Timo Liner well beaten here, and Mark Burdis now can give us the announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, at 1 minute 28 seconds of the seventh round, your referee has stopped the contest. He deemed Timo Liner was in no position to continue. The winner, and still the WBO Intercontinental Middleweight Champion, Tommy Langford! who will now be presented with the belt by Mr. Dennis Gilmartin. And a round of applause, please, for the gallant and brave Timo Laine.
Yeah, he was brave, but an educated performance from Tommy Langford. Too big and, frankly, just too good.
Absolutely dominant, exactly. Performance from Tommy Langford, the Commonwealth champion, retaining that WBO Intercontinental belt as well. Just past 27 then, Enzo. He's at a bit of a crossroads of his career now, isn't he? But he made it very plain he wants a really cleverly planned career with a world title about a year away. What do you think about that?
Yeah, you know, can't follow his performance tonight. Very workmanlike, very disappointing liner. You see the
Survivor, wasn't he?
Yeah, he had the sort of will punched out of him after two rounds. You know, it was a big chance for him. He didn't seem to try. And like you said, Survivor. As for Langford, yes, we'd love to see him step up. I'd like to see him something dangerous, something like a Spike O'Sullivan.
Yeah.
You know, he needs that sort of fight now if he's hoping to get to a world title.